Welcome to BBC What's New. Our first guest today is one of the most influential women on the continent. She is Monica Geingos, the First Lady of Namibia.
As well as being married to the president, she's a respected businesswoman in her own right, and she does a lot of work with young people in her country.
Iwent went to meet her and began by asking her what it is like to be a First Lady.
How is it to be married to a president? A lot of young people ask me that question. That being a First Lady is really being married to a politician who's very powerful, but it's not your power, it's his. It's much more glamorous looking than what it is in real life. It's a challenge.
So what's your favorite social media platform?
So the only social media platform I'm on is on Twitter. I love Twitter. Because it really lets me be myself. So I've got one civilized and First Lady account, which really just posts nice pictures and we did this and today we met who, and it's very orderly. And then I've got my own private account where I'm a little bit more free to share my views, and the people I engage the most are young people. I don't mind a young person disagreeing with me, but I want them to convince me why they are right. There's opportunities and there's also some threats. So we've got very high youth unemployment. So the private sector isn't absorbing as many young people into employment as it should, but that's also an opportunity for young people to become entrepreneurs. So I think that young people mustn't be demoralized.
Now, what have you put in place to support them?
So from my perspective, we run what's called the One Economy Foundation, and we've started a number of youth-focused programs, including what we call the Be Free movement. And what Be Free is about is really we engage young people and we want them to be free of whatever holds them back. So we're not even talking entrepreneurship with them. We're just talking basic life skills. Basically, we want to be a movement that walks alongside young people and enables them to make the right decisions.
You are an advocate for the UNAIDS campaign, yes, focusing on young girls and young women.
Yes.
Why that particular cause and what's your involvement?
Now, it's the UNAIDS Start Free, Stay Free campaign. And the reason for my involvement is that it doesn't make sense for countries like Namibia to spend so much money in ensuring that mothers don't pass HIV onto their babies. So we've managed to reduce our maternal transmission rate to 4% by the year 2020. We're looking at 0% where no mother passes HIV on to her baby. But what's the point of this huge investment of making sure that babies aren't infected with HIV, but then they go and get infected with HIV when they become adolescents? So the idea is to have them start free of HIV, but also stay free of HIV. I think the best advice for young people, and I know that your viewers are mostly between the age of 11 and 17, their focus must be on staying clear of decisions that will have a long-term impact on their lives, and make sure that the kind of actions that you undertake, that you protect yourself from consequences that will impact your ability to succeed in life.
Wow, what great advice. Now, here are some of the other stories making the headlines this week.
First up, after Nigeria's election was delayed by a week, Muhammadu Buhari has now been re-elected as president.
He won by nearly 4 million votes, but the main opposition candidate isn't happy, though. He's called it a sham election and has said he will go to court to challenge it.
Over in Senegal, President Macky Sall has also been elected for a second time.
Senegal has an average age of 19, and jobs and education were key issues for many voters there.
Next, this massive fire in Mount Kenya National Park has finally been contained after burning for more than 10 days.
That's right, it destroyed at least 80,000 hectares of bush. That's more than 50,000 football pitches.
Wow, that's huge. Hundreds of people from the local community, the forestry and wildlife services fought to control the fire, which is being blamed on illegal farmers clearing land.
And you may have heard of a fat cat, but this is one fat rat.
Yeah, emergency workers in Germany got an unusual call to help save a chubby rodent who was stuck in this hole.
It took 8 firefighters and an animal expert to get her out.
Bet she was feeling pretty ratty after that. Whee!
My name is DJ Switch and you're watching BBC What's New.
Now we're heading off to one of the largest cities in the world, Lagos. It's estimated that around 21 million people call this city in Nigeria home, and it's growing. With so much to see and do, it's kind of difficult to know where to get started. Luckily, we got a local to show us around. Take it away, Seth.
Hello, my name is Seth, and this is my Lagos. Lagos used to be the capital city of Nigeria, and millions of people live here. It's hot, noisy, and busy, but it's also my home. The first thing you'll see when you drive into Lagos are these three statues called the Arimeta. These three chiefs welcome all newcomers as they arrive. Lagos is Nigeria's largest city, and it's spread across the Lagos Lagoon. Some people even live on the water. The city is split into two parts, the mainland and the island, and connected by three bridges. The longest is the third mainland bridge. It used to be the longest bridge in Africa. When I'm not at school, I like to play sports. I play basketball, football, and fencing.
In Lagos love. It's delicious. Lagos has lots of history and culture.
You can find out more about this at the National Museum or Theatre.
And we love art!
Lagos has to offer you. If you'd like to find out more, just come and visit for yourself.
Thanks, Seth. Next, from Africa's fastest growing city to its largest country, Algeria.
Yes, the elections are coming up in April, and the president, Abdelaziz Bouteflika, has announced that he will be running again for the fifth time.
But many people, including students, have been protesting in Algiers and four other cities demanding that he step down. Nora has more.
President Abdelaziz Bouteflika has been in power for 20 years, but has rarely been seen in public since he had a stroke in 2013. However, the 82-year-old wants to run for office again, despite thousands of Algerian students protesting against him. Many are angry about the high rate of youth unemployment and say he's not well enough to rule.
We are against the system, that's all.
We're against his fifth term, we're against the system.
The system needs to change.
We want him to go, we want him to go.
We feel that it is time for a change, it is time to give other people the opportunity to give their best and to serve their country in the best way that they can.
So who is Bouteflika? As a young man, he fought to help Algeria gain independence from France in 1962. Then, in the 1990s, he helped bring peace after a decade-long civil war in which tens of thousands of people lost their lives. In 1999, Bouteflika became president for the first time. He was considered a symbol of hope for Algerians back then, which is one of the reasons why Algeria was less affected than other countries during a series of uprisings that spread across North Africa and the Middle East in 2010 and 2011. These uprisings were known as the Arab Spring. The Arab Spring was a movement of protests by young people who felt that their governments were not doing enough to create jobs, stop corruption, and fight poverty. It started in Tunisia, where the downfall of President Zine El Abidine Ben Ali on the 14th of January 2011 inspired others across the Arab world. The movement quickly took hold in Egypt, Libya, Yemen, Syria, Bahrain, Saudi Arabia, Morocco, Algeria, and Jordan. While the Arab Spring brought down oppressive regimes in certain countries, it has also had the effect of leaving some of them open to terrorism, like in Libya and Syria, where thousands of people have been displaced. And that's what some Algerians are worried will happen if Bouteflika steps down. The government says Algeria has been one of the most economically stable Arab countries since Bouteflika came to power. And despite the protests, some voters would agree.
I think we need to be careful who are the people protesting. Some protesters have been trying to destabilize Algeria, and it's in times like these that anything can happen. Look at what's happened in Syria and in Libya.
In reality, I feel sorry for Bouteflika because he has done so much for Algeria. He deserved to go with dignity.
Following days of protests, Bouteflika said in a letter that he has heard the concerns of thousands of youths, and although he is running again, he will not serve the full 3 years as president if he wins. But young people there are continuing to demand change.
Now, boxing is often seen as a male sport, right?
Well, not anymore! Well, there's this 7-year-old girl from Nigeria who's trying to break down this image, Hannah Misekinat, and this is her story.
When I first told my dad and mum that I want to be a boxer, my mum said no, that I'm a girl. But my dad said, look, yes, you can do it. My name is Sekinat Kadri. I'm 7 years old and I'm a boxer. I like the way my coach teaches me. Jab, double jab, 1-2. I want to be a world champion like Anthony Joshua. The names of the boxers I like are Muhammad Ali, Leila Ali, Clarissa Shields, Anthony Joshua, and Mike Tyson.
Sekinat loves boxing truly, but I don't want her boxing to affect her education. Even if she wants to fight, it will be on Saturday and Sunday. From Monday to Friday, she will be in school. Then after she's done in school, she goes for her after-school classes because I don't want anything to hold her back. Education is key.
Whenever my friends want to fight me in school, I'll say no. Come over into the ring and let's fight. I like to tell girls like me who are scared of boxing that boxing is not hard. You will just do jab, 1-2.
Jab, 1-2.
Yes! Go, Sekinat. Awesome stuff!
La 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 la!
Okay, yeah, sounds really nice, Isaac. But to be honest, I'd rather hear our next guest sing. They're the Watoto Children's Choir from Uganda, and they're amazing. They've sung to crowds around the world, and they've moved people with their songs. Andre went to find out more.
We are Watoto! This is my story.
Meet Watoto Children's Choir.
My name is Frank, and I am 11 years old.
My name is Maxwell and I am 11 years old.
My name is Patience and I am 7 years old.
My name is Maria and I am 11 years old.
Almost every day of the year, the choir is performing somewhere in the world. Tonight, they're in London. So what is Watoto?
Watoto means children in Swahili. Woo!
These children come from Watoto, an orphanage with a difference in Uganda. It was set up to help some of the estimated 2 million children in the country who've been orphaned by either war or AIDS.
Children in the orphanage live in houses of eight, which are part of special villages. Each house has its own mother, like this one.
What was your life like before you came to Watoto?
My life was not good. We were having one meal before we came to Watoto.
It was very hard. In a day we should eat one meal, and that was supper.
My mom had to work hard to get for me school fees to get school.
I couldn't go to school. My mom used to work very hard to make sure I go to school.
They played in some pretty big places, the White House in the US and Buckingham Palace in the UK, to name just two.
Before you go on, do you feel scared? Do you feel excited?
Excited. Enjoy the music.
Our first concert, I was not excited.
You're feeling a bit scared?
Yeah.
Yeah, and then when you start singing, do you get over that and you just enjoy it?
I just enjoy it.
So what's the best bit of being part of an internationally touring choir group?
My favourite thing is we dance and singing.
My favorite thing is I see people's lives changing, and I like singing and dancing. I like seeing people enjoying joining us as we sing and dance.
Now to a special place, also known as Spice Island.
Yes, Zanzibar earned this nickname because it grows and sells lots of spices. In fact, for a long time, it was one of the world's largest exporters of cloves.
But sadly, they started making fewer cloves in the 1980s because prices fell. So, to make up for it, the government has turned to tourism.
And spice tourism is really popular, and I went to Mr. Abed's farm to take a tour of my own. With its white sandy beaches and crystal clear waters, Zanzibar is considered a beauty haven, and it's earned most of its money from tourism.
And visitors come here not only to enjoy the sun, but also to get a taste of its spices. From cosmetics to oils and food, every corner you turn, you get a whiff of cardamom, pepper or clove. Its history in the production and export of spices has earned itself the name the Spice Island. Its economy relied on clove export, but this changed in the 1980s as wild prices declined.
But while earnings from clove exports is declining, spice tourism is booming. And we're going to take a tour around Mr. Abed's farm. Come with me. You have lots of different plants on your farm.
Yes.
What kind of plants are we going to be looking at today?
We're going to show today cardamom, black pepper, cinnamon, turmeric,
wow,
nutmeg, and the king of spices is cloves.
You said it was the king of spice. Why is it the king of spice?
Yeah, because it's cloves, the spices, also because it's a medicine. Oh. And this is the young one. We just pick it, the whole thing here. And then we drain the sun, getting black or brown. But the best quality is brown, not black. And the cloves can use as a medicine. For example, if a toothache can use clove oil, and your mouth will be numbing. And also the cloves also for oil, for medicine, for muscular pains and for massage.
Oh,
also the cloves for stomachache. They make tea and drink it, but it's very strong. Okay, we talked already about the king of spices. Now I'm going to show you queen of spices.
Oh, that sounds exciting.
So this is a queen of spices. Do you know what it is?
No, I'm not sure.
Let me show you.
Okay.
Just cut it. Can you see?
Oh, wow, it's beautiful. Is it called a queen because it's very beautiful?
Yeah, because you can use also for women, for wedding party.
Oh, women like this at wedding parties.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Ah, I've never seen nutmeg like that. It's always crushed.
Yeah, this is fresh ones.
Ah.
You have to dry in the sun.
You have to dry it and then crush it.
They're getting brown.
So do you use, what is a red pulp?
It's called mace. Oh. You put in masalas.
Oh, so you can use that as
well? Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The benefits of Zanzibar's spice trade trickle down through the economy, and although it does not export in the quantities it used to, it is still a vital business for the Spice Island.
Now, this story has a bit of a buzz. We're off to Ethiopia to meet this man, who has a very unusual relationship with bees, who he says follow him everywhere.
People call me the father of bees or the father of honey. They came to visit and stay with me, so I consider them family.
The Gosa family home is a hive of activity, literally. Bees turned up here 15 years ago, and they've never left.
The hive alone used to produce 25 to 30 kilograms of honey, but I made it smaller. It's never been a problem for the kids, but sometimes it disturbs the neighbors. Because of that, I tried to get rid of the hive, but the bees came back.
My friends are afraid of the bees, so I have to go to their place to study. When I ask them to come over, they're afraid the bees might sting them. Gosa says the bees love to follow him wherever he goes, but no one is quite sure why.
When I traveled to three different towns, each time a colony of bees came to nest around me. I don't see myself as different from other people, but I accept if it's meant to be.
Oh, I don't think I could live with all those bees, but that's all we have for now. Don't forget you can find more from the What's New team on our YouTube page. Just go to youtube.com/BBC What's New.
Yeah, make sure you hit the subscribe button to keep up to date with all our latest interviews and stories, and comment on your favourite ones too.
And we'll see you next week.
Bye. Bye.